That was
at the press conference with the U.S. attorneys in heaven. Wasn't that like your first month on the job?
Yeah, it was first couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, we hit the ground running.
Yeah.
We were ready to get
baptism by fire.
Amen. There was no time to waste.
So you guys,
y'all ready?
Yeah, we're on. Chief, you can say and spell your first and last name just so everyone has it correct.
Okay, Chief Roberto, R-O-B-E-R-T-O, Arredondo, A-R-R-E-D-O-N-D-O.
Okay, just for starters, unfortunately, this is something that is not foreign to the community right now. We've seen a lot of these cases. Just walk us through what you know right now about these two people arrested and the unfortunate 15-year-old who passed away.
Yeah, it goes back to June 13th of 2023 when we received a call of an unresponsive juvenile female that unresponsive in her bed. She was found by her grandmother. Along with the police department, the fire department was there. We transported her to a local hospital, which led us to an investigation. The family was very cooperative, which gave us the opportunity to search the juvenile's room. In doing so, we found 10 blue counterfeit pills inscribed M30, which led us to suspect that that was going to be fentanyl. Later they were tested and they tested positive for fentanyl. That led us to an investigation, obviously, into where those fentanyl pills come from. Carrollton undercover officers were able to, through the investigative work they did, were able to determine two dealers, not just the person that dealt to the deceased juvenile, but also the person that dealt to that person. So we went up the chain and we were able to get two drug dealers out through this investigation.
What sort of connection do these two drug dealers, and correct me if I'm wrong, the female is the one who sold to the teen and the male is the one who sold to her?
You're correct.
Do these dealers, alleged dealers, have any sort of connection that you are aware of to the dealers that have already been arrested through these investigations that we've seen for the past 6 months?
You know, that's something that we're working with our federal partners to try to ascertain, try to determine what the connections are, but at this time I don't have that information in front of me. However, we're working with our federal partners to work that out.
And these pills, what this girl who passed away, unfortunately, what did she think she was taking? Did she think it was Xanax, Percocet? Did she think it was fentanyl? What do you know?
Yeah, I don't know. I can tell you that these opioids are very addictive and that they're willing to gamble with their life in order to suffice their addiction.
Can you tell us a little bit about the suspects that you arrested?
There's not a lot of information that I do have on them other than Lopez is 24 and Pareto is 19, and they're from surrounding communities.
Do you know if these sales took place on campus or off campus, or do you know?
No, it would have been off campus for this particular sale. School was already out.
And with school being out, I know when we first talked about this months ago, there was an effort to get the message out and make sure that the SROs were even working harder to prevent this from being on campus. But now here you have the summer months coming in, and you don't have that extra layer of protection where SROs have their bird's eye view on people throughout the day. How concerning is that just for your department when these kids, you know, might be doing whatever they're doing throughout the summer? Unfortunately, see more of these deaths.
Yeah, so we're extremely concerned. That's why we're working so hard to try to rid our community of this poison. We've got a great group of officers, undercover officers, street officers, SROs that are working every day. They've been educated. They have great training. They understand what they're looking for. And we've had some great success. And so we're dependent on our parents to take an active role in their child's life and inspect their phones, look through the rooms and make sure that they're not using these illicit drugs, but also, you know, if they see a change in them, a change in their behavior, then to do something to look into that.
Is any other message to parents right now, especially the ones who might be sitting at home and not thinking that their kids have a drug problem?
Yeah. Have the conversation. Be involved. Be engaged. Notice if your child is acting differently and pay attention to who they hang out with. You know, these are relatively cheap counterfeit pills. I understand that they can be from $6 to $10, so they don't need a lot of money to in order to purchase these. But take an active role in their social media and take a look at what they're doing. Much of the social media interaction when they're buying these drugs are usually through emojis, and the emojis will tell you. You'll have to figure it out, but there's different ways of seeing that this doesn't make sense. You know, so pay attention to what they're doing.
And then as far as the kids go who are using these drugs, the message has been put out there. Y'all have been in front of cameras and making posts on social media. So has the DEA. So has the U.S. Attorney's Office. Like, we know this message is out there. So I know you probably don't have a specific answer, but is the message just not getting through to kids? Do these kids think they're invincible? I can't put myself in an 18-year-old's shoes right now, but if I knew that this many deadly pills were getting circled around my neighborhood, I would not take them. But why do we keep seeing this?
Well, I don't know. I don't have the answer, but I can tell you that it is an issue across the nation. It's just not in our community. It's in many communities. It is something that we've got to come together regarding. We've got to have our Texas legislature continue the good work that they did this past session, and parents need to understand that we're here to help, and if they have questions to reach out to us. I cannot tell you why a child would gamble with their life other than they don't understand. They don't quite grasp how deadly and dangerous this is to their life.
To follow up with David, there seems to be a lot of these happening in Carrollton over the last 6 months, maybe a year. Any idea why that is, and what are you guys coming up with some different, maybe new ways of combating this?
Well, as they say, I won't say that, but I'll tell you, we are very aggressive in weeding this out of our community. There is nothing more precious than our children, and I will fight until I can't fight anymore to rid this community and other communities of this poison. We're not just finding this poison in Carrollton. We're finding it in the surrounding cities and in the Metroplex, and we're following this web wherever it takes us, because I think it's too important not to. And so we are getting a lot of attention in Carrollton, but it's because of the great work we're doing in Carrollton as well. Now, the arrests and things that you are aware of come because we are taking it very serious. We're leaving no stone unturned, and we are doing all we can to rid our community of this poison. For those drug dealers that think they can operate in Carrollton, they're dead wrong. We're going to put a stop to it. We're going to do all we can to rid our community of it.
Is there kind of any beginning of a maybe interagency, not with the feds necessarily, but with other local police departments? You guys are sharing information and kind of maybe developing a task force, if you would? Is that something you
So there's a task force already out there with HIDA. It's been in operation for many years. We're in communication with the DEA and other federal agencies. We have officers on most of the different task forces that the federal agencies provide, because we want that intel sharing. We want that communication with the federal agencies, and we want that support. And just like in this case, we've taken these charges federally, because, you know, if found guilty, they could face up to 20 years in federal prison. And that's a key, and that's important to us. And again, I want to make it very difficult to operate in the city of Carrollton.
Last question for me. So from what we've seen at the legislature this session, correct me if I'm wrong, there is a bill that's been passed that will make a case like this an automatic murder charge. Can you talk to that, and is that your interpretation of it right now?
I'm still working through that with our attorneys. I was on the phone with our DA, Judge John Cruz, today, talking through that. We're both discussing what this House Bill 6 means to us and what we're going to do. We're hoping that is exactly what we get out of the bill, is that we get to charge someone with murder if they sold illegal drugs to someone, a dangerous drug that caused their death. I was in support of that, and again, I went to the Texas House this year and spoke on behalf of House Bill 1581 that was later adopted into House Bill 6.
Anything you want to add we didn't ask you?
No, I think you guys understand my point here. I am laser focused on removing this poison from our community. Our officers are doing a fantastic job. They're working as hard as they can And we ask that parents partner with us, help us rid our community of this poison. We got a great relationship with our federal partners, the U.S. Attorney's Office, the DEA, and also our school districts. Carrollton Farmers Branch ISD and Louisville ISD, both are great partners to us, and we're doing all we can. We're going to continue the fight.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, guys.
Perfect. Thank you very much.